Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa. Homage to the blessed, noble, and perfectly enlightened one. Namo sadanto suche doye alahadi samyao samputo che. Together, Wu sang san san wei miao fa, bai qian wan jie nan zao yu. Wo jing jian wen de sou chi, yuan jie ru lai zhen shi yi. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to see and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual meaning. Okay, so good evening, everyone. Welcome to Berkeley Monastery, and welcome our friends online to our sutra lecture on Saturday night. Today is March 19th, 2016. And as you can probably guess, Reverend Heng Sure is not here on the big silver screen. Jing Husher and myself will be giving the lecture tonight. So what we were thinking of doing this evening was to go over the 10 Dharma Realms verses by Master Hua. We began those 2 weeks ago when the power went out and we had a lecture in the dark. And so we thought, because we just started it, we would continue to explain them to give people some... you could say, context and understanding about the nature of the Buddhist, the way the reality is, the way the different realms of reality that are available to us as well in this moment, as well as in the realm of existence. And this particular series of verses were written by Master Hua while he was lecturing the Avatamsaka Sutra in the 1970s. So I think it's very fitting that between the Avatamsaka lectures, we look into these verses to give us some, you could say, understanding that might help us to approach and understand the Avatamsaka Sutra. And so to begin, I would invite everyone, maybe we could start out with our regular invocation of the Avatamsaka Sutra. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. So we can recite that 7 times. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Pu Sa. Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui So welcome everyone tonight to the, you could say, Dharma Realm versus lecture. The Dharma Realm versus lecture. We're not quite doing a sutra lecture. We're doing verses that, you could say, complement the sutra, that illustrate the principles in the Avatamsaka Sutra. And so for people who are here in the Buddha Hall, we have a couple of the verses printed out on two sheets of paper that you can see. Also online, there's a link for you to click if you want to look at the pages. You're welcome to take a look and see the verses that Master Hua wrote with some preliminary translations of those verses. If you have feedback or suggestions for the verses, if you have a poetic background, please give your feedback and ideas. We're happy to improve them. But I wanted to share that this is actually an extremely important 10 verses for us coming to learn the Dharma. You could say this outlines where we can go with our cultivation. This tells us that basically these are the places that we can end up in our practice. And it depends on what. Master Hua called these the 10 Dharma realms beyond a single thought. So Master Hua wrote these verses connecting them to this present thought that we're having in our minds. So what we're hoping to do today in this lecture is to go over the realms, but particularly to go over how it connects to the thought in your mind this very moment. Now, the only way that it'll connect to the thought in your mind this very moment, because Jing Husher myself, at least I don't know about Jing Husher, at least for myself for sure, I don't have any ability to read people's minds. You have to read your own mind, or at least be aware of the thought in your mind so that you can connect what we're saying to the thoughts that are happening right now in your mind. And what is the heart, what is the thought in your mind coming to listen to the sutra lecture, coming to the monastery? Is it a thought of joy? Is it a thought of selflessness? Is it a thought of equanimity? Is it a thought of wishing to realize Buddhahood? Is it a thought of, you know, I'm here because everybody else is here, or not that many people are here because, you know, then I'm here to, you know, so what's the thought in the mind that we have? And so that's what I would like people to investigate as we lecture, to not just listen to us, but also watch that thought, and people online as well. If you're listening to us speak or watching us on the YouTube channel, rather than clicking on another email or another web page and then listening to it in the background, is to watch your thought in your mind. What's going on? Right? What's going on in that thought? And to see, well, when we're going through these 10 Dharma realms, what realm is that thought going to? I think that's the most valuable. And that's the most useful for us in our spiritual practice. And Master Hua wrote these 10 verses to give very succinctly the essence of each of these realms, and then tried to connect it with the thought in our minds. So he gave commentary on these verses, and if people are interested, you're welcome to go read those. But we'll be giving, you could say, another commentary on them, another explanation of them, to relate it to our lives right now, to unpack them a little bit. And if people have questions and thoughts, please do ask and share. We're trying our best to make it relate to people's lives. Okay, so that's, you could say, the aim for tonight. We're going to be going over a number of the Dharma realms to give people some, you could say, sense of what we can do in our spiritual practice. What is our potential? So to begin, I just want to do a quick recap of what we did 2 weeks ago. We went over the first verse, which is, if anyone wishes to understand all the Buddhas, past, present, and future, observe the nature of the Dharma realm. Tathagatas are made from the mind alone. 若人欲了知三世一切佛，应观法界性，如来为心造. So that's the first verse that we went over last 2 weeks ago. And that was an adaptation of a verse from the Avatamsaka Sutra. I think people are very familiar with that verse. That's the verse we recite in evening ceremony every day during the Mongsan offering, but Master Hua slightly tweaked it to say the Tathagatas are made from the mind alone, saying that if we cultivate our minds, then we can realize Buddhahood. All right, so that's the first thing we went over last week about how we create the reality that we're in from the mind, the thoughts that in our mind. And then we went over the Dharma realm of the Buddhas. And that verse goes, Buddha Bu Xiao, Fei Chu Fei Lai, Wei Chen Si Jie, Jiao Ying Lian Tai. The Buddhas, neither big nor small, neither do they come or go, in worlds many as motes of dust, shining mirrored on lotus thrones. So last week we talked about how Master Hua made a joke about how when he first heard the Buddha, he thought it was not big. And so that's why this verse goes, Buddha Bu Xiao. So he thought that's a really good way of describing the Buddha. The Buddha is not arrogant, right? He's not arrogant. And also he's not small. Doesn't have an inferiority complex. He's completely free of those things. He's not big and not small. And then we also talked about how the Buddhas, they sit on their lotus thrones and they shine out light and shine on each other, interpenetrating throughout the universe without any obstruction. Right? Jing Husher shined his flashlight on me because that night we had no light. Literally, all the power went out because our transformer outside the monastery, I think it fell. The cable broke. This cable snapped, so the power went out. We had some karmic. You could say we for some reason we're probably supposed to lecture or something because the power went out exactly at 7:15 and came back on at 9 p.m. So it was just exactly during the period of the lecture time that we couldn't broadcast it online. So we had to lecture in the dark. But Jing Hao just shined his light on me, his flashlight on me during that lecture because we had flashlights to lecture. And so that's what the Buddhas do, but they don't use flashlights. They actually can emit light. And the point that Master Hua particularly made was that the lights shine on each other and they don't obstruct one another. And that's the spirit of the Buddhas that we can encompass and have in our own hearts, is that if we can be around everyone else and we have no obstruction, no collision, completely rejoicing and supporting other people's goodness, and they rejoice and support our goodness, and we mutually illumine and we mutually go on this Buddha path, then that would be the realm of the Buddhas, if we can always be that way. And so that was what Master Hua really pointed to, this kind of non-obstructed, interpenetrating reality. So that's what we talked about last 2 weeks ago. And so today, we will begin the other Dharma realms, starting with the Dharma realm of Bodhisattvas. Do you want to add anything to my introduction? Yeah. Okay, so I'll read the verse, and then Jing Hushu will begin the explanation of the Dharma realm of Bodhisattvas. So the Chinese goes, Yo qing jue wu, tiao chu chen ai, liu du wan hen, shi ke pei zai. So when living beings awaken, out of the dusty world they leap. Six perfections, all practices, in each moment they cultivate. Okay.
So this afternoon, Jin Chuan Xuan and myself, we discussed how we would approach this evening. And I'm not sure if you mentioned it earlier, but so our plan is not to present all the Dharma realms to you as laid out in the book, because all of you can read the book yourself. But what we would do is to pick out points, whatever points that we come across that are useful to us being in the human realm, or at least those of you sitting in front of us right now and online. What is there in the other realms that are useful or immediately
practical
that we can actually apply, either as in what to do or what not to do. So the reason I'm starting with the Dharma realm of Bodhisattvas, or me speaking instead of Jin Chuan Shou, was in our discussion, I had this experience that made me, that gave me a bit of understanding why they use the word dust. When living beings awaken out of the dusty world they live. Does anyone here have an idea why dust is used? For example, in other areas of the Dharma as well, like for example, when the Buddha gained his awakening, the Lord Brahma told the Buddha there are many with little dust in their eyes as a reason for why the Buddha should teach. So dust is used as a metaphor. Does anyone want to share what they, do they know any idea why the metaphor of dust is used? Because it's a lot, okay, definitely. Okay, there's a mic, but I can repeat for those online. Because there's a lot and you can see, right? Yes. That's right. So my experience was the first time I came to the city of 10,000 Buddhas, and I was just sitting in a Buddha hall and I wasn't even meditating because I didn't know how to meditate at that time and I'm still learning. So I was just sitting in a Buddha hall and there wasn't any ceremony going on. And I realized something was different. I felt really different. And it was not just being in a Buddha, it wasn't because I was being in the Buddha hall or far away from home. I realized that my mind was not thinking of all the things that I would have thought about if I was back home, such as what I was going to do for the weekend. I realized that was, my mind was free of that. Who was I going to call? My mind was free. Not having a phone to check for messages, for emails, because I had come to CTV to be a monk, I had no job, so no responsibilities. I had no bills to pay anymore by that time. I did not have any friends to keep in touch with because I had said goodbye to all of them. They all knew I was there. All those things that I, that were part of my old life that I had taken for granted, that my mind would just move, you know, were gone. And that alone made me feel different. And as recalling back my experience when those things were part of my life, I did not realize that my mind had those dust.
The dust? What's her name? Oh, Alice.
Sorry, Alice. Alice said, you don't see the dust. We are surrounded by dust, but we don't see it. But under what circumstances can we see dust? When we have light. You open a window and the sun shines in and the ray catches all the dust and oh. And if you happen to move like a cushion or a blanket or even your clothes and you get amazed like, whoa, there's all this dust. And then the light goes away or you turn your head and suddenly the dust is gone. But it's only gone from your consciousness. It's still there. You're just not aware of it. So I gained a bit of understanding of why dust is used, the leap of the dusty world. Because we are surrounded by dust in our minds. Our minds are constantly thinking of stuff. There's always things that we have to think about, responsibilities. And that's a normal part of, I guess, being alive, being a normal human being. But we are not aware of it. So with the light of wisdom, then we can see the dust. But that's not the point of that we want to highlight for the Dharma realm of Bodhisattvas.
Well, it's the beginning part of it. The other part is, so actually Master Hua asked, so do you think, do Bodhisattvas still have to eat? Do they still have to wear clothes? Do they still need a house to live in? And he said, oh, very good.
Check emails.
Check emails. Do they still need to check their emails? No, they're a modern bodhisattva. Hopefully not checking emails. They'll really be free of the dust. But he says, actually, yeah, very good. The bodhisattva still eats food, still wears clothes, still lives in a place to stay in, and potentially, so the master didn't say email, but you could say maybe potentially still checks email. He says, however, he doesn't live to eat. He doesn't live to wear clothes. He doesn't live to for their house or live to check their email, live for their, you know, whatever device that they have. Rather, they live for what? They live for the six paramitas. So they eat the food, they wear clothes, they abide in a place to stay in order to facilitate their realization and perfection of the six paramitas, the six perfections. So rather than being a slave to those things, they're, you could say, a master of them. They are able to use them for awakening. So that's how they leap out of the dusty world. It's not that they somehow no longer do those things. Rather, they are no longer mired in it. They're no longer stuck in it, right? And so for all of us here, I think it's actually a very simple question to ask ourselves on a regular basis is, why am I doing what I'm doing? If I wake up in the morning, you know, what's the first thought in my mind? Is the first thought in my mind, let me put on my clothes, let me get some food, let me, or is it, okay, today I'm really going to wake up and, okay, I need to, you know, get some food, get ready to go so I can go meditate and go, you know, bow to the Buddhas and then go off to work and see what good I can do in the world today and maybe help my coworker out or maybe make my mom happier today or my dad more peaceful, you know, maybe take care of the kids and make sure that they're, you know, got the good kind of a healthy, happy life. And that's what I'm here for. I'm here to serve. I'm here to give. I'm here to practice goodness, to hold the precepts. That would be the mindset of coming in with a bodhisattva mind, not coming and wake up in the morning, oh, I just want to get through the day. Just get through the day. Okay, then day's over. I got through the day. Next day comes, oh, I got through another day. Day in, day out, day in, day out. And then you're just, you could say, a slave to the dusty world. The dusty world controls our lives. But if we can use the dusty world to awaken, then we can leap out of it. And so rather than seeing the bodhisattva's realm is so far away, you know, far, far away, in fact, Master Hua was pointing to, it's right here in this thought, in this very thought, you're sitting in this room or you're on your computer listening. It's right in this thought right now that you can see your mind. Why am I doing what I'm doing? Why am I listening to this lecture? Am I here to... In fact, actually, in the lecture, you're doing a lot of good things. One is you're holding precepts. You're not killing, stealing, lying, sexual misconduct, or intoxicants, right? You're potentially giving. By being here, you're inspiring others to listen to the Dharma as well and making the Dharma assembly come to life.
Listening to us means you're already very patient.
Yes, that's right. Very, very, very patient and vigorous. And hopefully you have a little bit of concentration. I see no one's looking at their iPhones, so that's a little bit of concentration, especially in modern times. And we're learning the sutras together, so we're having a chance to understand at least literary prajna. And by investigating with our minds, maybe a little bit of reflective prajna as well, some contemplative prajna as well. So we're trying our best to practice the six paramitas. That would be, and vigor, yeah. As I've joined that with your patience, to listen to us, to take some vigor. Patience and vigor. And so together, all those six are the six paramitas. And if we are using that as our motivation to, you could say, exist, to kind of move forward in our lives, then that's going on the path of awakening. If we're just going towards the dust to satisfy the senses, to make our bodies comfortable, to make our ego okay, then that's just a dusty world. See?
Yeah. So one way I see when I'm contemplating or thinking about why the Rama Master would lecture on this, at least for me, one way I see it is the 10 Dharma realms is like a, you know, when you play spin a bottle, the 10 Dharma realms are around us and our thoughts are like a compass. So we can have a thought of, say, like a Buddha, and then that points us there. And that means the next course of action that we do brings us closer in that direction. Conversely, if we have a thought within the six parameters, giving, holding precepts, patience, vigor, concentration, and wisdom, it means that our compass is pointed towards the realm of bodhisattvas. And if everything we do is guided by these six perfections, then everything we do is leading us towards this realm. Conversely, when we go to like the realm of asuras, we'll find out later what it takes to get to the realm of asuras. So I think one of the reasons Rambo Master gave us this is to show us that it all starts in the mind. The Ten Dharma Realms are not beyond a single thought. That's the name of the book, the title of his lectures. It all starts with a thought. A single thought has the potential to bring you to any of these 10 realms. So what the Bodhisattva does is, at every moment of thought, instead of being consumed by the sights, sounds, smells, tastes, and objects that he sees in the world, although he's within the world just like any of us here, his mind is always on the six perfections, the six parameters. He's always governed. His compass is always oriented towards giving. Am I doing something? Or are my thoughts based on the precepts? Am I being patient? So like what Jinchen was trying to say, the moment we get out of bed, like in the monastery when we eat food, before we eat, we have the words to contemplate, where does the food come from? Have I done anything to deserve this food? This food was given based on the generosity of, what's that term? Of donors. So it makes us mindful of what foundation am I building for myself to receive this food that I'm going to eat today? Am I basing it on desire? Am I basing it on selfishness or on a scattered mind? So monks, we eat in silence because we're really, how would I say, controlling the mind not to get into the flavors of the food. And pulling the mind away from the sensations and the taste to, how would I say, either concentrating on our Dharma door or one of these six perfections and developing a sense of gratitude.
So because there are so many verses, we were hoping to go over a couple of them. Do you want something else for the Bodhisattvas? Maybe the next one? No? Okay. So does anybody have any questions particular? Oh, Alan had a question, looks like. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So maybe we'll get the mic. I just seems to be a long question. Yeah. Okay, so Alan's comment sounds, and if I get it wrong, you can correct me, is that the idea that we're slaves to kind of our life, just get through the day, that 80%, that only describes 80% of the people, because they go kind of live paycheck by paycheck because they have nothing that they can do, but that the 20% who maybe are more well off, then they can just live abundant blessings so that they kind of don't have to worry about that. And so the 80% need to get enough money so that they can get through, so that they can then live like the 20% who can be more well off. That's your question? Okay. And so your question is, can you explain about the 20%? Yeah. Yeah, spiritual liberation. Yeah. So she's saying, Alan is saying the lack is the money rather than the spiritual. However, I would just say this actually applies to both the 20% and the 80%. Because my sense is that if you look at, we want to use this lens, I don't know if so much that money is the marker of really being able to cultivate to a certain extent. For sure, there's a certain amount of peacefulness by having enough blessings so you're not, starving and completely impoverished, so you can't even, barely survive. But
I'm a monk. I can't cultivate because I don't have money.
But my feeling is that basically, the nice part about the Dharma is that does not require you to have money in order to practice. So if you wake up in the morning and you just start the day out saying, okay, how can I be of service in the world? It doesn't require money. Maybe your job is to be doing some very simple work, in society, cleaning or helping out in certain ways. That's wonderful work to cultivate with. Your mind can be free to use it on your Dharma door and transfer the merit for the goodness of the world. While somebody who's the CEO of a huge company making maybe $10 million a year, in fact, they might be really afflicted every morning. I mean, I think it seems to me that a lot of people are more slaves to their schedules here in the Silicon Valley being really successful than other places in the world, because we're so successful that we have to do all this stuff all the time. And so we're just moving at kind of high speed, and we never get a chance to say, okay, why am I going so fast? And it's just a slight orientation. And so my feeling in the morning is a really good time, because before we launch out into the day, if we can catch ourselves a little bit, then we can at least send ourselves out with the right direction, with the right intention. If we just launch out haphazardly, then we end up, to be honest, in a haphazard state of mind at the end of the day. Day in, day out, that becomes our habitual pattern. And then if you think about the Dharma, then at the end of our life, that's still our habitual pattern. And then we go off to our next place, still the habitual pattern just goes on and on. We start out confused, we end up confused. It goes from day to day, it goes from moment to moment. So right now, sitting in the Sutra lecture to the end of the Sutra lecture.
Did that answer your question?
Okay.
Were you also suggesting that only when someone has enough material, has had their material needs being satisfied, then they can, that is the foundation for practice? That was not what you meant. Okay. So I think when Chin Chuan Shou used the word slave, he was describing how the bodhisattvas are able to go through the same things as we are, but they are not a slave, they are not bound by the things they do. I think one way to look at it is that their happiness is not determined by the outcome of material wealth. So you can have two people, both having to work because you have to survive. If you don't work, you don't have an income, you can't provide for your family or for yourself. That's the reality of life. But their mental attitude towards that could be very different. On the outside, it could be the same. But internally, if one person doesn't get what he wants, that determines his quality of life, his mental quality. He's only happy if he achieves certain milestones in his life that's determined based on material wealth. Whereas the other person tries his best or just as hard or even harder, but his mental faculty, the health of his mind does not depend on those things. He will have a different set of criteria of where he derives his sense of well-being from. And what am I referring to? It would be the six parameters, for example. So he might do charity, but if he's poor and he's unable to actually give material wealth, he may have time. Or he may say, the only thing I can do is donate blood, which is a really good act. And that gives him a sense of well-being that someone who is rich might not have if they don't go through the same set of perfections. So I think what the Buddha was trying to say, or what the Bodhisattva realized, is that the way to happiness is not through material wealth. It helps. It definitely helps, especially with responsibilities. But the happiness comes, proper mental health, a sense of well-being, might come from more mental, how you see life, how you see people, how you treat people, rather than getting stuff. Yeah. And we'll come to that later when we. And we'll come to that later when we talk about mixed karma in the realm of humans.
Does the Bodhisattva have any ambitions? That's the question. Ambitions or goals? Because in modern times, a lot of young people are told that they're supposed to have ambitions and goals.
I think when we look at, say, ambition or the reason behind a vigor, Rinpoche Master says that to be a Bodhisattva is really difficult. And you can figure it out for yourself. You can try it. Just hold these six perfections, governing all your thought and your action, and you see how difficult it is. I think you have to look at intention. What's your intention? Recently, someone that I know came and said that, why would you want to be a monk? I said, that's difficult to answer quickly. And he said that, the way I see it, you monks and nuns lead extremely miserable lives. You're not enjoying yourself. You don't have anything. You know, you live in, he probably saw a monk's room. So you live in miserable conditions. No heat. City TV, no heat, yeah. And he said, like, you know, it seems like such a painful existence. But one of the things that I think all monks and nuns practice is the four Brahma Viharas. And that's something you don't see because it's internal. Just one thing, the first thing of the Brahma Vihara, which is called Abode of the Gods, because that's how gods are, is compassion. Okay, let me start with metta, loving kindness. What's loving kindness? The wish that all beings are happy, that they don't suffer. So you're not going to see that when you see someone who's practicing or someone who's practicing the Brahma Viharas. But if someone really believes in that, and that's the intention behind everything they do, including going against the grain of what everyone else does, like a Bodhisattva, giving, holding precepts, patience, vigor, concentration, and trying to get wisdom. How can someone with that intention, I'm doing this so I can get the wisdom to save beings so that they will always be happy? Wouldn't that be for someone who's attuned to that, be kind of ambition to strive for, especially if you look at like Utstal Bodhisattva, when he saw his, before he became Utstal Bodhisattva, and he, at that time she was a she, and he, she saw her mother suffering. That was the only thing she wanted. And she made a vow, may all, she expanded, so from compassion, may beings be free of suffering, that's compassion. From karuna, it became maha karuna, great compassion. That I want to be responsible to liberate all everybody's mothers from suffering. And that's how she became a Utstal Bodhisattva, based on that vow. So would that, so for, at least in the Bodhisattva's case, that's one way to look at, would they be ambitious?
Yeah, I was gonna add that it really, what Jing Hajar said was, it's about intention. And so it's tricky because oftentimes indeed when we use the word ambition in a kind of at least in this area there's a sense of like being ambitious to be successful in ways that the world defines success. You'd be money, you maybe get a position, maybe what your parents tell you you're supposed to be, and you want to get some kind of particular occupation. Right, there's a lot of things that come in with that word ambition, and it's often the ambition has a sense of a self moving forward and getting something. And so I think the word that we often use in the Dharma, rather than using the word ambition, is the word vows. And I think there's a sense that you're basically aligning your mind to a certain direction. I'm moving in that direction, and he's aligning his mind or her mind to the six paramitas. So you could say, if you want to use that same language, say, yeah, the Bodhisattva is very ambitious. She's trying, or he's trying to perfect the six perfections, which is a tremendously difficult thing to do, right? But ironically enough, this ambition is ultimately going to be emptied. If we go through the Avatamsaka Sutra, the irony of this is that the sixth perfection of wisdom, what happens is it actually perfects the perfections because you're able to let go of the self. You say the real perfection of giving is when you let go of the self, you let go of the gift, you let go of the receiver, and you see it as all as empty. You don't attach to any of it. So you, because what you realize is that fundamentally our awakened nature, or what we have already, is this potential to give. It's a potential to be vigorous, it's a potential to hold precepts perfectly, and it's already naturally there. So the ambition is actually nothing we had to go get outside to get. We just return back to what we already have. So the Bodhisattva is able to empty at that sixth stage to really perfect the paramita. So it's kind of like this loop process. It's like you go through it, and all of a sudden it goes back, and you realize, whoa, I didn't have to get anything. Like in the Heart Sutra, it says, the Bodhisattva has nothing to attain, and therefore is able to let go of all delusion. So that's a realization. That's an actual practice that one does. And so actually today, this week, there was something that stuck in my mind in our Dharma class, which was that if you really want to think about emptiness, you could say that it means nothing, but nothing lacking. You lack nothing. So actually that nothingness is actually, you realize that you actually lack nothing, you're complete to begin with. And what you're complete with, you're complete with the six perfections, the six paramitas. So I don't know if that kind of answers the question a bit. So yeah, I think, yeah, if the young person wants to really be ambitious, I'll say, go for it. Try to be a Buddha. That would really be ambitious.
Yeah. I think because I work with a lot of youth sometimes as volunteering, and I think recently I noticed that one struggle, I mean, they want to be bodhisattvas and they want to do good in the world, but I think what Alan was saying, they find the struggle of the practicality of, say, you know, trying to perfect the six paramitas, and then the, unless they become a monastic where, you know, they fully go into this bodhisattva path, but if they're still in the worldly world, then there's the practicality of, you know, not trying to seek for a good job or not trying to get into a good college or even at work there are people that sort of bullying, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And then they're trying to practice the Bodhisattva path and becoming this totally good person, and they feel like people are taking advantage of me. I think that's like, unless they're in the, like a student, she's at Harvard right now, and she's been trying to practice the Bodhisattva path for a long time, and then she goes to Harvard, and she finds things that are happening, and she goes like, wow, those principles that I learned before, I can use it and apply it when I'm around good people, but then when I'm around people that are like that, then they're struggling to make those vows and those aspiration work, I think, yeah.
It's a good question. It's a very good question. Maybe the first thought? First Alan?
Well, I would come back to if someone is really, the heart is set on the intention, where is your heart set on? If your compass wavers, and sometimes you feel that you want to, you waver to a different realm based on, say, material wealth, greed, lying to get ahead, because everyone does it. If I don't do it, I'm going to lose out. So if your compass orients there, just be aware that your compass orients there. No one's forcing you to do anything. But if for someone whose heart is really set on orienting towards a wholesome path, say like the Bodhisattva path, then the guidelines are, for example, like precepts, the Bodhisattva precepts. So someone who say, I want to take the Bodhisattva precepts, and one of the precepts is not trading in firearms, then he thinks, yeah, but you know, my cousin, he's like a firearms dealer, and he's making so much money, and if I can just make this one deal, you know, I can sell a boatload of guns and bombs to this person, and I'll be rich, and I'll be able to provide for my family. So then his compass, then where does he want to orient it? Everyone's different. There's sometimes a natural time that things just, the compass just is so strong that everything else is not important. Yeah, sure. I can sell guns, and then if I find out that someone gets killed because of the gun I sell, I don't care. I'll be in my big house. My children will be provided for. And if you're fine with that, you know, we'll come to views later. That's one view to hold. And the Buddha didn't tell anyone, you have to do this, you have to do that. What the Buddha was trying to do was just be aware that certain actions lead to certain outcomes. And if you take this course of action, it will lead to this kind of outcome for yourself. No one else. And there's no one to blame. We will come to that later when we come to the realm of humans, which I'll read right now. Humans abide in harmony, merits and misdeeds interspersed. That means we have good things and we have bad things. We have good choices, bad choices, wholesome, unwholesome. On good, they rise; with crimes or unwholesome deeds, they fall. Nobody else to blame at all. Right? So, it's true, there's a shortcut to so-called success, but what did the Buddha tell us about certain ways of doing certain things? That whatever you do, there's a corresponding effect. So bodhisattvas, they don't fear the results, they fear the causes. Whereas humans don't think about the causes, we just fear the results. So slowly, someone along the path, as they study more, as they get more sure of themselves and the Dharma, hopefully their compass becomes stronger. For someone who is not quite sure, they sometimes have to learn the hard way, or it's very hard to say.
I was just thinking about what would be a good response. My first sense in that kind of situation is, I would ask the young person, you have any heroes? Do you have any heroes? And who is the hero and what are the qualities that they have? And why did, how did they get there? Because I think that, and if they don't have a really wholesome hero, then I think it's very difficult. Because it's very easy to be moved by the people around us. But if there is a sense, you know, actually, because, I mean, I think it's true. People want to get a good job. They want to get a good college. They want to, you know, be number one in the class, and they want to take advantage of them. But those are actually things that if we seek after and attach to and compete for, in fact, it usually doesn't end up in a very happy state of mind. It doesn't mean that we end up being kind of a pushover in life. I don't, if you look at the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, they aren't pushovers. They're like great heroes. I mean, they go out and are able to do exactly what what Master Hall described. They're willing to do the things that other people are not willing to do. You know, they're able to really, you know, be successful in the ways of the world if necessary to be successful in that way to help people. But their motivation is very different. And my gut feeling is if we really looked at the heroes of the world, the good heroes in the world, those people embodied a lot of those qualities. And so if the young person nowadays says, okay, well, let's look at somebody who really spent their whole life fighting for position, trying to be number one. Let's look at one. Who would be an example of that? You can maybe think of somebody. Okay, so is that, how is that person's life? Are they happy? Now you think of people who live a life of selfless service, maybe, but still successful. I think a lot of people who live a life of selfless, Tsuchi is a very good example. I'm sure a lot of the people who are in that organization had devoted a lot of time into this kind of selfless work, but they were also very successful in the world. And what's the state of mind? What's the happiness there? Right? And so that's, I think, something that we can look to. Another place to look, I think, if you really want to have really strong stories, is service space. But people know Nipun Metta and that whole organization, they go and look for particular stories to tell of heroes, of unsung heroes, kind of people you never look at, you never see. Society doesn't put newspaper articles about them. So they go and highlight these people and say, you know, these people are doing good in a very small way, but that's really where it matters, bit by bit, bit by bit. And then if we can put our lens there and our priorities there, then we don't get moved by all the other voices that we hear that society puts as what's important. And the sense is when we look at the dharmas, then actually those are the seeds for real happiness. So take some wisdom. And it's often not always easy to see, especially at a young age. You know, I'm still fairly young. And so it's not easy to see, and it's something that I think that you learn over life, over time. You kind of go, okay. With the Dharma, you say, well, that actual cause of selflessness actually ended up in a result of happiness. This cause of competitive mindset ended up in a success, maybe, but somehow I also had a lot of jealousy and fear of losing it at the end of it. Is that what's the causal links to all these things that's happening in my mind? You don't have to look outside, just in my mind. What are the seeds I'm planting? What are the results I'm getting? So, I don't know. I would probably just listen to the person for most of my time first.
So the same trend I'm hearing from Alan and yourself is that it seems to be that success is a qualifier for happiness. This reminds me of the Dharma Sutta, in which the Buddha described a man, say a normal person, if he gets hit by a dart, the dart punctures his body, feels two pains, two kinds of afflictions. The first affliction is a physical pain from the dart. And then the second affliction is the mental pain that's associated with the body pain that's felt by the dart. And then he says, a worthy one, meaning one of his disciples, I think of either the four stages of arhats, feels the body pain, just like a normal person, but does not feel the second pain, the affliction of the mind. So the mind is totally cool. Yeah, my leg hurts, I'm cool. This reminds me of a movie I saw about this alien came down and he had a human body and he was injured. Someone asked him, are you in pain? He said, well, my body hurts. Meaning he is not his body. My body hurts, but I don't hurt. And the disciple knows, the noble disciple is able not to have the mental affliction because he has concentration. So that's another way of looking at how to reduce suffering. So I guess for someone who sees that success or reputation or fame is one way of happiness, would be then to explore, would there be any other ways of happiness that are available? And all this, what the Marble Master taught us, what the Buddha left us with, is not theory, it's not principle for us to listen to and say, yeah, that makes sense, and forget. All this only makes sense if it's put into practice. So for someone who's interested, oh, you mean there's another way for happiness, not just money, such as giving? No, that's stupid, right? How can I give? I like to receive. Giving doesn't make me happy. Give me, that'll make me happy. Until he tries it. There's an occasion, like Jin Chuan should say, service space, where you give. And then you like, how does that feel? So maybe more opportunities then for to hold the precepts and to apply them. But then you need to have the mind also to observe the effects on you. And why did the Buddha give us the precepts? Because the precepts are the foundation for concentration, happiness. A happiness that is not, that you cannot get from any material item that far surpasses any fame, any money can, anything money can buy, or anything someone, 1,000 people liking you on Facebook or 1,000,000, that even surpasses that kind of satisfaction. But it only makes sense if you actually try it out. Until then, it's just theory. So maybe someone who's skillful can slowly introduce different ways of trying out certain things and letting them see for themselves.
Maybe one last thought would be, also at the same time, I don't think you want to have an additional level of pressure on oneself. It's not like a, how do I say it? So this, what Jing Hoshu says, this is basically guidelines, a framework, ways of understanding your life. It's not like a should. You should be like this bodhisattva and you're not like this bodhisattva, therefore, you know, you're a bad person. That's not the tone of it. It's saying, this is some principles for your life. And if your aspirations are to be successful in the world and do good things in the world and follow that path, that's fine. The Buddha explained how to do that, how to live a good life in the world. And his thought was, because if the person is successful and happy in that process, then over time they trust the Dharma, then later they'll want more. They'll realize the impermanence of that as well, and then they'll go on for more Dharma. So he says, if you want to be successful in the world, be successful in a proper way. You know, work hard, don't try to get off easy, but do a good job. And then you'll realize the goodness that comes in the realms of the humans and gods, right? And that has its goodness to it. That's, if you're satisfied with that, that's a place to start. But then at a certain point, when you go, wait, I want to do more, there's more to go on. And this, by being introduced at least to these 10 realms, you know there is more to go on.
So these are actually issues that we have. The principles will cover these questions in the realm of hearers, which are arhats, and the realm of humans, and seeing that we don't have much time, do you want to go to the hearers?
Okay, so I'll read the verse of the solitary sage, and then the realm, say just maybe two sentences about it, and then we'll do the hearers. Okay, so the verse goes, Yuan Jie Sen Xian Gu Feng Du Mian Chun Hua Qiu Xie Shi Er Lian Huan. The pinyin is very small. And the English goes, sages awake to causation, sleep alone on secluded peaks. So I have a new translation on your sheet. I think something goes like, spring flowers bloom, autumn leaves fall, in 12 interconnected links. So these sages are contemplating the 12 conditioned links, which we went over for quite a few months with Reverend Heng Sure. And ourselves too, when we were doing it for almost a year, I'm guessing. So that was happening before. And this is the 12 conditioned links is what the solitary sage practices out in the forest. So people like to go out in nature and contemplate the forest. If you really can have very deep insight, this is where you can go. But we were thinking that because most of us here probably aren't, so probably none of us are going to be going out into the forest for long term at the moment. We were going to go into the hearer realms because I think that's going to be more applicable to people's experience. So if we can read the, I think we can maybe read the verse together since we have the pinyin, if you can see it. The next one, Sun Wen, yeah, hearers. So Sun Wen Fa Jie, Dharma Realm of Hearers. Sun Wen Zong Sen Bu Lun Nu Nan Si Di Guan Xing Ying Shi Shi Quan. The noble Sangha of hearers encompass both women and men. Study and practice the four truths, real hidden, provisional shown. Okay.
So what we thought we would concentrate on would be views, because the Noble Eightfold Path is within here. This is the Four Noble Truths that the sound hearers practice to end birth and death. So a stream enterer, which is the first level of an arhat, has severed the five kinds of wrong views. And why we look at views? Because the Noble Eightfold Path starts with having right views. So you start with right views that are built on, such as all of you listening to the lecture. So you have, that's what literary prajna is. You listen to the lecture, you read, you discuss the Dharma, and you contemplate on the Dharma. So you start with that, and that forms the foundation of your practice. Right, livelihood, everything, all is built on the foundation of right views. And then you end with wisdom. Transcendental wisdom, wisdom that comes from within yourself, like how the Buddha had discovered the wisdom within himself that we all have. But you have to start with learning. Okay, so I'm going to show the... I'll show... Yeah.
You have some fun posters. Do you want to show the poster?
Yeah.
Okay. Tell the history behind it a little bit. Okay, so like I'm going to try to recap what Jing Husher said. So Jing Husher is into graphics things, and so he found posters online of really cool posters. People have been like little iconic graphics of like various philosophical ideas or emotions or thoughts, and so he was trying to capture kind of iconic images that would capture Dharma principle. So taking the principles or the kind of iconic images of our experiences in modern life and bring it into the Dharma, which I think is actually a very Dharma method, because what the Buddha did in his time in India was he took the symbols of the Indian mind and took those and converted it over to the Dharma. So it'd be really good if people were to look at the images that they had in their daily life and be able to connect it to the principles of the Dharma as well. So
if you look up in a dictionary, the views are described as a particular manner of looking at something. And the second one is contemplation or consideration of a matter with reference to action. So that's how academic dictionaries defined views. Okay, and this is the poster. This was the only thing I could find that could define views, you know, like how a cameraman or a director might try to frame a scene. But in Buddhism, views are translated as an opinion, and the two sides of views are right view or correct view and wrong view.
You do what you think is good.
So I'll just read this. This is an excerpt from the Princeton Dictionary of Buddhism. Right view is the first constituent of the Noble Eightfold Path. It is described as a correct understanding of the Four Noble Truths, namely, the truth of suffering, the truth of the cause of suffering, the truth of cessation of suffering, and the truth of the path leading to the end of suffering, which is what we just read. For sound hearers, this is what they practice to become arhats. Right view is also identified as a correct understanding of non-self. So basically, for any person who wants to practice based on the Buddha's teachings, which I think is all of us, first, you have to make sure that you have an understanding of what it means to be right views. Because if not, all your practices then are built on a foundation where your compass gets swayed left, right, up, down, based on your environment, right? So the right view, okay, I'll repeat, is identified as a correct understanding of non-self. And right view also refers to the understanding of the vision of truth. That means being able to accept and understand cause and effect. And I think it's better if we go through wrong views. It's a lot easier to identify wrong views, okay? There are five kinds of wrong views. One, the view that there is a self or a soul, like a personality. Like for example, like me, Jin He, when I die, although I don't remember who I was before, but I'm very confident that when I die, I'm going to be the same person but in a different body. So that's a wrong view. I'm still going to be me, but I'm going to be in a different body. And I have no basis for that. I can't even remember who I was before I became me in this body. But I'm very confident that who I am I right now is going to continue to another existence, this personality, this Jin He, right? That's a wrong view. So as we go through life, how do we see ourselves? Do we hold that view? And is our practice based on that? Okay, so that's one wrong view. The second wrong view is called an extreme view, where someone goes in the direct opposite, saying, when I die, that's it. There's no more me. There's no more habits or whatever going across. There's nothing. When I die, that's it. Nothing carries forward. There's no continuation. Okay? So that's the second wrong view. The third wrong view is called fallacious views, where someone does not believe or rejects cause and effect, rebirth. Let me clarify.
Efficacy of karma. Yeah, karma. Cause and effect. This is cause and effect. Karma is like basically action. Well, this is talking about intentional action. Efficacy of intentional action. Basically, you think, like for instance, that you can't really have any control of your life, right? So everything is fate. Everything is already prearranged. There's no efficacy in anything I do. The Buddha says, not quite right. That's not right. I mean, there's a lot of things that you've created in that past that was habits that came and made us who we are now. But you actually have, quote unquote, efficacy of your karmic actions, efficacy in your intentional actions to then plant new seeds that could end up in a different future. So this moment right now, we're planting intentional actions with the thoughts in our minds, and your body is just sitting there quietly, which is a good action. You know, your mouth is probably not talking, so you're maybe reflecting inward. So your body, mouth, and mind are creating intentional actions as we speak, that are sending you off into the future. And so this would, depending on what kind of seed you're planting, is what kind of realm here you're going to end up in. Right? So that's say there's an efficacy there. And that really matters. And that's actually in Buddhism where all the emphasis is on this present moment's intentional act. That's what we're about. You know, that's really important. That's intentional action. So it's important. You know, you don't want to believe there's no intentional action. Then you end up in a dead zone of a kind of a depressed cynicism. a lot of things happen in that space. Okay. Rigid and attachment. Oh, rebirth. So basically, if you deny that there's rebirth, that's considered a you could say a misguided view. And the reason is because then in a way you go, well, I just live my life and nothing matters afterwards. And so it's, although I have to say this is a very tricky one in the modern West, because we grew up in a very materialistic way of looking at our existence. You know, somehow this body is it. And then so when it dies, kind of that's it. Nothing else happens. But in Buddhism, we actually look at the mind and the consciousness, which is a stream of habitual tendencies that continues on life to life to life to life. And so I think what might be a more skillful way to look at it, because it's hard to say, okay, believe in rebirth. I don't think, you know, it's easy for just people to say, okay, just believe in rebirth. Okay, I don't believe in it. You know, on what proof? Is I think if it's not something that people naturally have an inclination for, then keep the mind open. Say, potentially there is rebirth. You know, it's not, do you have proof that there isn't? Right, there's been studies and things that some, you know, there's been people who have near-death experiences who report things. There's various studies around rebirth and things like that. But in the end, it's hard to quote-unquote prove in the way that some people want to have that proved in their hearts. And so I think might be most skillful is keep it open in your mind, but pay attention to your intentional action right now. Right, keep your intentional actions wholesome and leading to a good realm. And that's the skillful now. When you die, I guess you'll know. When the moment comes when you're dying, you'll be like, well, okay, so now I will probably find out, is there rebirth or not?
Okay. So far, the first three views, the first three wrong views, that there is a self, the personality, an ego that goes forward. Okay, second one, there is no self. After when my body ends, that's it. Everything ends. The whole universe ends. The third one is not believing in cause and effect, such as I can eat cake every day, lunch, breakfast, dinner, and it will not affect my cholesterol, for example. Right? Fallacious views.
Gosh, I never knew that.
Yeah. Or smoking.
For sure.
Or say the meal, if it's... Okay, I shall not go there about meat. These are all speculative views. You don't know. One way or another, you don't know. But you just feel this way. I want to believe this. Right? So the fourth one is actually this. The fourth wrong view is the rigid attachment to views that are mistaken and you cling to stubbornly and are speculative. So you don't know either way, but as far as you're concerned, this is the truth. And then your actions in life are based on those.
This sounds really concrete, at least for myself, because I definitely know I have this habit, which is basically, I kind of talk as I think. So I kind of brainstorm out loud. And so I say something, and if somebody challenges what I'm kind of just thinking out loud, sometimes I get confused and think that's actually like a point of view that I'm taking, and then I start defending it. And I end up in a very confused state trying to defend a fallacious view that I've attached to, thinking that I want to kind of maintain my pride and ego around a view. I don't know if that makes sense.
Are you confused? I'm confused.
I think it's a very natural, at least for myself, natural tendency, but I think that's something that we often experience, is that we actually collapse our minds around a particular view, and then we get in fights with it, right? I mean, to be honest, if you had any argument with anybody else, there's definitely a view involved. You have a view, they have a view, and that's coming into collision. And there's an attachment to a view that's colliding with the other attachment to the view, and it's a difficult thing to work out, because basically there's no quote-unquote right way about it, because the views are right in of to themselves, until somebody can say, oh, wait a moment, actually that was a fallacious view. And if you have the humility to realize that, and go, okay, actually, sorry, I realized I just was attached to my point way of seeing things, and actually I can see it from your view, and actually that makes sense too. That's fine, no problem. Right? That was definitely I told the story quite a few times when I was a kid growing up. I was very opinionated, and basically I remember one friend, actually not my friend, but he was a schoolmate, coming and making fun of me, saying, oh, you're very argumentative. I don't know if people remember this story I always say, right? And I said to him, what? I said, no, I'm not. And then they said, see, you're arguing. I said, that's not fair. I had no chance. I couldn't even say, if I say yes, then I'm argumentative, then you're right. And if I say no, then I'm arguing. So it's like a lose-lose situation. And I, like, as I reflected, I said, now, I think the more skillful response would be saying something like, you're right, I am argumentative. You know, if I, in the future, am still argumentative, please let me know and I can prove myself. Whew. Clear. No problem. No view hitting another view. It's accord. That's the bodhisattva kind of according with living beings, right? But once I have a view of wanting to protect myself, of wanting to be right, then every move I make, I'm in a conflict with another being's, other being's view. And if that being is trying to poke at me, then I'm in conflict. So this one, I think, is a very useful principle, because we see it all the time. And the Buddha already pointed out very clearly, that's actually a misguided way of approaching things, is when you attach to a view rigidly, right? Okay.
And then the last one is rigid attachment to the efficacy of rites and rituals. Say, the classic example in the sutras would be when the Buddha were to speak about the Brahmins believing that bathing in the Ganges River will cleanse away all the unwholesome deeds that they have done, for example, that's one. Or burning fire, and how you perform the act, how you light the fire, how many sticks of firewood you arrange, and how you arrange them, and saying the words at the right time, in the right manner, in the right order, is supposed to lead to some efficacious result. So, coming to the question earlier about how financial success can be, say, one marker in life, to the extent of someone totally disregarding, say, cause and effect, you can see why the Noble Eightfold Path starts first with right view. It's not that you have to see these things, but you become aware of them. So when you become aware of them, say, huh, okay, so if there's no self, like one of the wrong views is the body is not self. So if the body is not self, then you start thinking, you start contemplating. What else did the Buddha say? Why do I have this view? Why do I think this way? So it's not that you have, a wrong view. It is, why do I think this way? What can I read more about what the Buddha said regarding this? So same for cause and effect. Cause and effect, what is it? Is that something that I can see? Is it mental habits of the mind? That if every day at a certain time I drink coffee or I take a drink, then after a while, it becomes a habit. Is it just like that? Then you start investigating for yourself and you start developing your own wisdom. So the Noble Eightfold Path starts with right views, which is the foundation of all your practice and how you see yourself, life, and the teachings.
So maybe to flesh it out then. So, and if you had all those wrong views, then what view do you have, right? And so what Jinghajir described in the very beginning was basically the Buddha says, so what you start with, and we're on the realm of the hearers, You start with the Four Noble Truths. That's a skillful view to start with, because that view accords with the way things are. And so what is it? It says, well, things are always, you know, all the things we experience is impermanent, is in flux, right? Can any of you look and think of anything that you've experienced that's lasted forever, that will stay around forever? Well, not really. And so if that's, everything's in flux, then how can we rely on it for our happiness? Then this, is that the case that ultimately things are unsatisfactory? Yeah, I can see that. I think that's not difficult for people to experience nowadays because things go so fast. You know, we buy a new, he has his poster. What's impermanence? He's got it, impermanence. What do people guess? What would be a nice icon for impermanence? Jing Hunter's first idea was using the Apple logo, because the Apple, they keep changing every iPhone, like, you know, impermanence. We thought we had a different one. He came up with impermanent.
Yeah, I didn't want to get sued by Apple or using the trademark. So
you got a floppy disk. Impermanence. How long does that last? How long do we use it now? But things move fast now in the world, and so we're always being encouraged to buy the latest, newest thing, and we're dissatisfied with the one we just got. And so that experience of dissatisfaction, I think, is actually a very common experience, to the point that, in a way, we think that might be actually how we are as people. We're just always dissatisfied, always dissatisfied, always dissatisfied. And the Buddha says, okay, well, the second noble truth is seeing where that comes from. It's not coming from outside of you not getting what you want. It's actually coming from the seed of it is coming from your craving. The experience of it might be conditioned by the external, but the actual seed of it is your craving, the mind that wants to get and feels like it lacks something. It's not complete to begin with. And so you go out, right? So that's the second noble truth. The third is that there's a way out, so it's not hopeless, right? You don't end up in a kind of a miserable state, just depressed. And then the fourth is that the way out is to cultivate the Eightfold Noble Path. There is an escape. Buddha says there is an escape from this. And so somebody who has right view sees the situation and uses that analysis to find a way out. So for instance, if the young person were what Valerie described, you know, out in college and in a situation, I'll say, can you try to figure out how the Four Noble Truths would apply to that situation? Can you see, well, what are they looking for? People are looking for, you know, wanting to get this thing. Well, is that leading them to real happiness? Well, no, it's not. So what do you do? Well, you realize, okay, if I don't seek after it, it doesn't mean I don't still work hard and do what I'm supposed to do. But if I don't seek after and attach to it, in fact, I will actually find true happiness. Okay, yeah. But they have to see it for themselves. They have to look at their life, look at the people around them. Ideally, they have a friend or a mentor who embodies this kind of happiness, joyfulness, contentment that they can look to and go, oh, wow, okay, I want to be like that person. Okay, then I can do this, no problem. And have the confidence to go forward. But if they only see people who are seeking, and don't have any examples of real happiness without that, then it's hard, I think. It's really hard to have that confidence.
So yeah. Right within the first noble truth, then, is to see that the things that you're chasing for, will they give you the happiness that you think it will? And what the Buddha did when he spoke to people who were not his disciples, he would point to their own experiences through their lives, to their own lives. So it would be something like, oh, you really want the new iPad? Yeah, I want it. Well, what happened when you got your old iPad? Well, it really made me happy until the new one came out. And I'm not satisfied with my iPad anymore. So the Buddha would point back to something they could reference, that the theory becomes real. It's not theory anymore. So the first noble truth, you need a skillful way to point to their own experiences in life so that, oh, yeah, that makes sense. So it's not someone else's experience, it's their own experience. And then the second noble truth will then be, oh, it's because I want that. And because I'm not getting it, I'm not satisfied, and I get this. Can you guess what this is? I'll cover it. When you don't get what you want, what's this?
Looks like a spiky object.
Like a spiky. It looks painful. It's affliction. When you don't get what you want, it's affliction.
It's a
dukkha.
Dukkha.
Yeah.
It's affliction.
It's painful when you don't get what you want.
So, well, I don't know. It looks like our time is more or less there, and we didn't.
And then you need patience.
And then you need patience. People recognize that symbol? Let's show the symbol. Loading symbol from on your computer. You have to have a Mac to have that work, though. That's the Mac. What's the Windows equivalent would be the hourglass? The hourglass symbol? Patience. Yeah, so you can cultivate patience when you see that symbol on your computer screen. Or the blue screen of death, one or the other.
That's affliction.
Oh, yeah, you hear the blue screen of death on the affliction one. Well, so we didn't go through all of them, but I hope that at least some of these ideas made sense and that you could apply it in your life. My sense is that this series of talks is actually very useful to read because it actually gives context to what we're doing with our lives, and then we can choose what we're going to do, right? And so it's actually fairly short. It seems very simple. It seems, you know, it's like a short little booklet. In the end, though, Master Hua gives a comment. He says, you know, in 1,000 years' time, many people will awaken from reading this. Then he says, however, at this moment, it's not for sure if any of you will awaken. So, you know, he says, don't take this work very lightly. It has the seeds for something, I think, quite tremendous in the future. So for us, if we can take these teachings and apply it in our lives, then you know, then we can actually be, you could say, master of our destinies. We can choose where we end up. We're not just pushed around by our karma. So,
okay. So in closing, whenever you go about your life, be aware of the how you're framing life around you and yourself, and make sure that your compass, if you want to use the Bodhisattva realm, the six perfections, as a way to guide yourself, that would be a really wholesome thing to do.
Okay, is there any last comments or thoughts? Anything online, Jerry? They like the poster. People on the computer like the poster. Oh, good lecture. Okay, no praise. You can't get not moved by praise. It's definitely one of the Dharma realms. Okay. Unfortunately, we don't really get that. We definitely don't. How to describe? We're definitely learning in our lecturing abilities. Let's just put it that way. So we know our abilities. Okay. In terms of announcements, we have Guanyin session coming up. Not this week, but the following week, which was starting, let's see, March 27th, we'll have Guanyin Bodhisattva. Okay, actually, March 26th, they'll have Purifying Boundaries. March 27th is it Guanyin Bodhisattva's birthday? Leaving home day? Anybody know? Leaving home day? Okay, Guanyin Bodhisattva's leaving home day. So people are welcome to go out to see 10,000 Buddhas and celebrate Guanyin Bodhisattva leaving home. And then if they would like, they can participate in a week session. I looked at the calendar, they're also transmitting through refuges, so if people want to go for that, you're welcome to. Otherwise, at Berkeley Monastery, we have a regular schedule, as usual. Actually, one thing that came up that if people would like to dedicate their merit to is that next week we have WASC coming to visit the RBU. It's the actual time has come. The Accrediting Agency of Western Association of Senior Colleges, I think, schools and colleges, is coming to visit the university, Dharma Realms Buddhist University, and to see how it's doing. You know, how's the program? Is the university doing what it said it's going to do in the application? You know, it's a 100-page application with supplemental material. The page didn't with 100 pages, so it was like 99 or 100 pages that was turned in, a thick document. And so the accreditation agent is going to come and take a look at the university and see, okay, are you doing what you're doing? And by the end of the week, they'll give us some inclination, pretty good, about what they recommend to the accrediting agency to say, is the ARBU accredited or not? Or what stage of accreditation it is. So that's a big thing. And so somebody mentioned to us about transferring merit at another talk, which is Sudana Center. I just want to mention that if people would like to, you can transfer merit there as well. I'm sure people will appreciate it. And it's a big step for sure for the university. It's bringing, you could say, the vision of education, of this kind of wisdom based on our humanity, to society. And it's, you know, both Jinghansh and myself are in the master's program, and I watch the bachelor students, and I have to say it's actually working. I can see the young people thriving in that environment. And actually, just in comparison to what Valerie was mentioning before, is that they're not thriving on a competitive mindset. In fact, the environment is such constructed, it's actually developed in a way that's mutually supportive of a careful listening to one another, so that what he says, I maybe can learn from what he says, so I should pay more attention. Okay, oh, that's an interesting idea. Let me see how I can use that in my life. That's the spirit of it. And by having that the underlying spirit, the people that grow from it, I think, are very special and very interesting to see. So anyways, we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. Anything else? No? Okay. Yeah, one more announcement. A food demo.
Okay, so we will have a food preparation demonstration. Is it this weekend? What are the dates again? Next Saturday, the 26th of March, and the 26th and April 9th, one of our friends of the monastery, Peggy, will be here. What time again? 3 to 5 on a Saturday. So she'll be here to demonstrate and explain how the method of preserving foods and the health benefits, and like sauerkraut, for example, how to ferment like the sauerkraut, daikon, which is Japanese yellow radish, you know, which is really tasty. And then there's that, the yeasty thing, what's that? The yeast starter. It looks really horrible, but apparently it's really good for health. Like all things that look and taste horrible. But no, these are really good, and it will be held in our dining hall from 3 to 5 on March 26 and April 9. Is that right? Okay.
So I think it's healthy vegetarian eating. Healthy vegetarian, and then it's preserved so you can keep it for a long period of time so you can eat it all the time. So, okay. Otherwise, wish everyone a good evening, and we'll transfer the merit. If people have, do people need the transference of merit sheet? People online, I think there's a link for it online to transfer. In your heart, you can send it wherever you like in the world. You know, there's lots of places that could use the support. Okay. Yeah, you probably want a mic. Thank you. Share the fruits of peace with hearts of goodness, luminous and bright. If people hear and see how hands and hearts can find in giving unity, may their minds awake to great compassion, wisdom, and to joy. May kindness find reward. May all who sorrow leave their grief and pain. May this boundless light dispel the darkness of their endless night. Because our hearts are one, this world of pain turns into paradise. May all become compassionate and wise. May all become compassionate and wise.
Okay, we can all stand and bow to the Buddhas.